Howdy, folks, and welcome to Tiny Tent Show, episode number 12. As ever in these times, everything that follows is offered with respect to current events, and indeed in deference to events that may have unfolded between the time that we record this and the time you see it. That said, we also do our jobs. And our job tonight is to celebrate New First Night, which under normal circumstances would mean that right about now, the last of the audience would be filing into the tent. They'd be settling into their seats. The band would finish tuning up, and then the curtain would open, and a man would emerge.
Ladies and gentlemen, friends, neighbors, residents, visitors, lake sailors, land lovers, Chautauqua comers, one and all. For the waves of the summer roll out over you, I beg you, hear me out. How many of you in these trying and complicated modern times have not said to yourselves, if only I could see to the bottom of things? If only I could find my way through the thick, dark problem of living? If only I could learn to think clearly at will? Or at all. If only I could come to know my true self and the true selves of those who surround me. Now you ask, Dr. Third Eye, for I am Dr. Felonious P. Third Eye, graduate summa cum laude from the Lake Superior Underwater University for the Malcontent. I shall tell you, this is an opportunity for growth and change. You know the seriousness of what goes on. You know how you think and how you feel about what you think. You know that awful lies are told and retold, and that great truths are made manifest in large and small actions each and every single day. Is it hard to cope? Are you sad, angry, elated, worried, apprehensive, lonely, eager, and just tired of it all? Well, you are in luck, for you have something marvelous in you that neither I nor anyone else can sell or take away from you to deal with this mess. Hope. Hope. Yes, hope. Maybe so small it could hide behind a gnat's wing, but it is there. It lives in you. It nourishes your spirit. It keeps you going. It helps you get up each day and go. Go on. Go forth. Forward. Every step of the way. The steps to justice, equality, fairness, strength, kindness and decency. Let us take those steps together. We are worth the effort.
There he was, and there he goes. Bayfield County's own international man of mystery. Don't ask me, because I won't tell you. Well, now it's time to truly kick off New First Night, and we'll do that with a song that was written by Warren Nelson, and it has launched the Lake Superior Big Top Chautauqua season for years and years now. It's called Ballyhoo, and man, you gotta sing that chorus so that everybody in quarantine can hear you.
I can't believe another year's gone around. Is that a big top I see there lying on the ground? Ballyhoo, ah, ballyhoo. My big tent bag rolling in the sun. What we have here is a half ton of fun. Ballyhoo. sit up, snap off the stakes. My heart starts to flutter, my soul starts to shake. Ballyhoo, ah, ballyhoo. To the Chautauqua tent show, pack it up, let's go. 8:15, old circus time. Never seen such a sight on a sweet summer night. All canvas, music, magic, and light. It's big, it's blue, it's big top show time for me and you. Ballyhoo, oh, ballyhoo. Our sponsors, we'd like to thank Jim and Joy Perry, Jim and Joanne Collins, Star North Cornucopia, Brownstone Pharmacy Washburn, the Ashland Daily Press, Big Top Friends, the Bujolds, Manleys, Sandstroms, and Roths, Myra Ehnert, Movement Matters, Janet Sternett, Bayfield. To the Chautauqua Tent Show, pack it up, let's go. 8:15, old circus time. Never seen such a sight on a sweet summer night. All canvas, music, magic, and light. It's big, it's blue, it's big time, show time for me and you. Ballyhoo, oh, ballyhoo.
Blue Canvas Orchestra, the BCO, raising a ballyhoo with Philip Anich on the lead vocals. The next song we're going to hear was released in 1963 by Roy Orbison, and then released again in 1977 by Linda Ronstadt, and that's the one that probably caught the most attention in the U.S. Here in 2020, we have Severin Bainan and Danielle Diamond to take you from ballyhoo to Blue Bayou.
I feel so bad, I've got a worried mind. I'm so lonesome all the time. Since I left my baby behind on Blue Bayou, saving nickels, saving dimes, working till sun don't shine, looking forward to happier times on the bayou. I'm going back someday, come one day to Blue Bayou, where the folks are fine and the world is mine on Blue Bayou, where those fishing boats with their sails afloat, if only I could see
Danielle Diamond and Severin Bainan doing Blue Bayou just for you. Next up, a Paul Simon song that most recently was performed in the Big Top by Ladysmith Black Mambazo in 2018. Tonight, we're going to have BCO members Ed Willett, Jane Alexson, and Tom Mitchell performing You Can Call Me Al. Like that song because it reminds me of my friend Al, for real. Well, now I take myself to the woodshed to think about birds.
Howdy, folks.
Well, I'm hunkered down in the woodshed here. I was going to do this piece outside because it's an essay about birds and bird song, but it is tumultuously windy out there, so I've come for a little shelter in the woodshed, and we'll just read about the birds, and maybe you can hear those. I don't know. You also, if you listen really closely, you will catch the sound of a chicken or two. This morning, the gray rainscape was brightened by the sight of a dusky red mother cardinal pecking across the driveway outside my window. She was flanked by a pair of birds her same size. They were tan and of similar configuration. It took me a moment to realize they were her offspring. The clincher came when she turned toward one and it gawped its face wide open. The mother popped her beak down the youngster's gullet and deposited whatever it was she had pecked off the damp pavement. On she hopped and on she pecked, her children tagging close behind. Every few feet she stopped, turned, and stuffed one or the other maw. In light of their size, the younger birds looked ludicrous, not fending for themselves. I was reminded of adolescents wandering helplessly through a well-stocked kitchen, waiting for hamburgers to drop from the light sockets and string cheese to pour out the faucets. I may or may not have some teenager raising experience. It lightened my heart to see the youngsters thriving, however. Last year, a robin laid eggs in a nest not 3 feet off the ground in a spruce tree down by the pole barn. And while my younger daughter enjoyed checking the eggs, she got a dose of cold nature when a windstorm upended the whole works before hatching, leaving nothing but a frayed nest and chips of eggshell blue in the grass. Another robin has nested in the yard this year, a good 15 feet up in a young but sturdy maple. I can't see the eggs, but I can see her up there resolutely set. So far, so good. Then there were the wrens who built a nest in my office window, packing a narrow space between the sill and air conditioner with sticks and pine needles, and, I am told by the internet, spider egg sacks. Excuse me while I check my office chair and shudder. It was a bad place for a nest, but they had it well homesteaded by the time I discovered them, and over the next few weeks I came to love their burbling song. Such bright noise from such brown birds. Although I had to work hot, because every time I turned the air conditioner on, Mama Wren fled. I'd rather be sweaty than guilty, and so I rationed my cool downs. 2 days later, I heard a thump and the wrens scolding. When I exited the office, a cat was hanging by both forepaws from the windowsill. The nest was pulled apart, and a barely feathered wren chick was weakly weaving its wings. Before I could intervene, the chick was eaten. The following day, I hung a wren house within view of the office window. Amends, I suppose, or hope. I enjoyed writing to Wren Song, and I hope I may again. Birds and baby birds in springtime are a lesson in acceptance. Nature makes no investment in care or kindness. Your garden variety bird survives on determination and chance. The father cardinal and his bright red feathers, for whatever reason, are nowhere to be seen. I'm happy to report that I did see a father cardinal around again this year. And also, I hung that wren house, and that's been 3 years now since I wrote that piece. And every year, that wren house has been occupied, and they were singing out there this morning. So nature works it all out. Sometimes our job is just to stay out of the way. Oh, and also this year they started building a nest in between the windowsill and the air conditioner, and I felt bad, but I just cleared the sticks out before they even really got started, and did so for a couple of days, and then they moved over another 4 feet and built a nest in the wren house. So sometimes you do interfere with nature. Anyway, it's a beautiful day out here, and it's a pleasure to be sharing our thoughts and stories with all of you out there, and we're grateful for what you do to keep us going. Folks, I often find myself thankful for the people who volunteer, the people who buy tickets, the people who show up to the Big Top Chautauqua. It's a sincere appreciation, and it's easy to hold because we meet these folks face to face. I'm here now to speak about one of those people. In 1964, Jerry Carlson moved to Bayfield, and he began his lifelong pursuit of developing the Mount Ashwaubay ski area. He operated Mount Ashwaubay for the next 48 years. And in 1986, when Big Top Chautauqua raised its first big blue tent, and every year thereafter, Jerry was not only the co-crew chief of the tent raising and takedown. Going to put it up, you got to take it down. He and his wife, Carol, operated the Mount Ashwaubay concessions until 2012. This month, Jerry passed away peacefully, at home, surrounded by his family. And we remember him now.
Oh, Shenandoah, I long to hear you.
Jerry Carlson, King of the Mountain. We segue gently now from that memory into a nice song, a song called Smile. It's a Nat King Cole song, and in this version, Severin Bainan plays the piano, and our own Jack Gunderson handles the vocals.
Well, here we go with Severin Bainan in the background. An upbeat song called Smile. Thank you. Smile, though your heart is aching. Smile even though it's breaking. When there are clouds in the sky, you'll get by. If you smile through your tears and sorrow, smile and maybe tomorrow, you'll see the sun come shining through for you. Light up your face with gladness. Hide every trace of sadness, although a tear may be ever so near. That's the time you must keep on trying. Smile, what's the use of trying? You'll find that life is still worthwhile if you just smile. When there are clouds in the sky, you'll get by. You'll see the sun come shining through for you. Although a tear may be ever so near, that's the time you must keep on smiling. Smile, what's the use of crying? You'll find that life is still worthwhile if you just smile. If you just smile.
Come out almost every day inspecting in his cheek. He had a big fat stomach and a little pointed head, and everyone that saw him thought he was already dead. Na 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 na. And then one day it happened, the Pharaoh of Egypt came out to see how we were doing on his creepy crypt. He took one look at Tara, and him she did beguile. The next thing that I knew, they were both sailing down the Nile. And so I crept into the Pharaoh's crypt and cried. All alone there in that creepy crypt, I cried. I watched him sail away from me, my Tara by his side. So I crept into the Pharaoh's crypt and cried. The rest of my sad story is hard for me to tell. They had a royal wedding, they rang a wedding bell. I watched until she promised to be his faithful bride. Then I crept into the Pharaoh's crypt and cried. Oh yes, I crept into the Pharaoh's crypt and cried. All alone there in that creepy crypt I cried. I lost my little flower and my tears I could not hide. So I crept into the Pharaoh's crypt and cried. That's when I slipped into the sepulcher and sighed. That's when I crept into the Pharaoh's crypt and cried.
now for something completely different. We're approaching the summer solstice here, and here's your science lesson from the day, compliments of Monty Python. Just imagine that you're standing on a planet that's evolving, revolving at 900 miles an hour. It's orbiting at 19 miles a second, so it's reckoned the sun that is the source of all our power. The sun and you and me and all the stars that we can see are moving at 1,000,000 miles a day. In an outer spiral arm at 40,000 miles an hour of the galaxy we call the Milky Way. Our galaxy itself contains 100 billion stars. It's 100,000 light years side to side. It bulges in the middle, 13,000 light years thick, but out by us it's just 3,000 light years wide. With 30,000 light years from galactic central point, we go round every 200 million years. And our galaxy is just one of millions of billions in this amazing and expanding universe. The universe itself keeps on expanding and expanding in all of the directions it can whiz. As fast as you can go, the speed of light you know, 12 million miles a minute, and that's the fastest speed there is. So remember when you're feeling very small and insecure, how amazingly unlikely was your birth. And pray that there's intelligent life somewhere out in space. 'Cause there's bugger all down here on Earth. Happy solstice.
You know, they don't call it the Lake Superior Big Top Chautauqua because it's a pole barn, although there are poles involved. And unless we're in, oh, say, the middle of a worldwide pandemic, someone has to put that tent up. And there's no one better to talk about the ins and outs and the ups and downs and the oopses even of putting up a tent for all these years than our very own Philip Anich. So I gave him a call, a Zoom. Here's Phil. Well, howdy, Phil.
Oh, Michael.
Hey, I thought, you know, it seems obvious, but Lake Superior Big Top Chautauqua, they call it the Big Top for a reason. And sometimes maybe if you're sitting there taking in a show, it does not occur to you that that tent does not raise itself. So I thought we would talk about the history of tent raisings.
I was talking with somebody just the other day. They said that Paul Buckles came up there. They had just delivered it. It came from RC Tent Rental. Tom Quanbeck had some connection there. The way they dropped this old raggedy thing down there, and Paul Buckles said something to the effect of, I might be able to do something with that. But anyway, they managed to get it up. And I sang in the first shows, but I was kind of having to come in from Omaha or wherever I was around the country. I finally quit my job in 1988 and came back north. I just had to be part of this. And the first thing that happened is we did a show for Mary Rice's folks. The Bill and Betty Hewling Show, Bill and Betty Anderson Hewling. Anyway, we had a brand new tent, the first brand new tent. So my experience was putting that one up on the grounds of the Anderson Window Company. And of course, big learning curve. We had these big hunky boys that were showing us how to do this. And first they laid it out and step off the stakes, just like the song says. And then hammering in all these stakes, and this was former river bottom, and it was, and I learned a lot of things what not to do that day. It was a small crew of us, Jonathan Faulkner, me, Noel Meyer, Hank Cole. God, it might have just been us anyway, and we work like dogs, but trying to put the tent up, the old tents were made a little bit better than the current versions. And what you had is you'd lace these sections together, and there was a rope coming from each direction going up to the center pole, then going back down, and it went around a ring. So there's actually four rings that were converging at the top there. And so the tent is up, and now we put up the quarter poles, and we're trying to shove this 29-foot center pole through four different holes. So if we get through one hole, now we got to take the base and move it over here. At one time, we had Jonathan up on the roof of the tent with a come along, and it just took hours to do this. Incidentally, Jonathan was bleeding profusely three times in one day. Different wounds, you know. It was, but anyway, I learned what not to do that day. So then we finally go back north, and we're going to set this tent up again. And Warren thought that the tent was a little stubby looking, so he ordered another section. And anyway, while putting it up, I went and got nipple flange nipples, which is so I could put all the holes together and lock them all together at one time and have one hole to go through. That was a monstrous improvement. We just saved hours of backbreaking work then. And then, of course, in order to putting the actual tent up never really took too long. We're pretty good at it now, you know. And of course, finally learned how to do it after about 29 years, you know, where we actually used a forklift to lift the last 10 feet. Anyway, you know, everything's an experience. But we always had a good army of people putting the tent up. And of course, you slide the big bar through. That was something. There's a couple of things that I discovered. I was never a fan of trying to just wrap your hands around a pole and try to lift on it. So we kind of came up with welding a ring on there so you can shove a pole through, which is just a lot easier. Oh, another thing was putting ratchets on the ropes. When we would originally put the tent up, it was called, now we got to tune the tent. And it was like move around and move this pole and move that pole and tighten this and I'll move that around. And so eventually it occurred to me that, you know, this thing is designed by engineers. So why don't I just go and paint the footprint of the tent on the ground and we'll put the poles where they would be on the drawing. And what do you know? It worked, but we were butting heads at times, you know, about, you know, you're changing, you know, how things are done here, you know. My first year, though, I was an operations manager. I was hired as publicist, you know, so Jonathan was the canvas master, you know, but everybody was throwing in ideas all the time, you know. And of course, it's Paul Buckles who came up a bunch of the first years, and he's just strong as a bull, you know. But putting the tent up, we kind of had figured that out over time, and it went kind of smooth. The biggest thing that always bothered me was safety in every one of these. And people did listen. I would have to, I would say, raise my voice so that they could hear. And some people would interpret that as me yelling at them. So they'd say, yeah, you want to go? Want to go up and tent raising and have Philip yell at y'all? But it was kind of funny. But sometimes when we go to move the tent with the truss now there, and you got literally 12 people on a pole, we would bend that solid inch and a quarter pole. You know, I don't know how many tons were lifting there, you know. No, but anyway, we kind of, over time, we added tower material. These triangular tower pieces so the trusses wouldn't get wonky like that. And you know, so just went through all these different phases.
Yeah.
And then fate stepped in and the place burned down. That was in 2000. And Jerry Carlson called me up. Jerry said, it's all gone. I said, what are you talking about? He said, the tent, it's burned up. The whole end is gone. So I raced over there, and Carolyn and Warren were there, and Andy Oakey, a few other people. And I knew that we had this, we bought a whole bunch of stuff from the St. Paul Chautauqua. They tried to duplicate what we did on Harriet Island down in the Twin Cities. And so we had a tent in storage. And so I said, well, I'll tell you what, Carolyn, I'll be thinking about how we can retrofit that existing tent that we have. It's about the same size as what we've got. And I called the guy up and I said, hey, I got to put this tent up. I've never done it before. He says, it's the busiest time of the year for us with all these spring weddings. He said, I can't help you at all, but I'll give you one hint. Don't push the top of the pole through the top of the tent. You know, you get kind of the material would overlay the top. I thought, that's great. Click. So that was the only advice I got. But we had a bunch, you know, every time we put this up, there's a lot of smart people that showed up time and time and time again. You know, Bob Derby, Dave Twerk. I mean, the list is, you know, there's dozens of people. So there's always been some good, smart people that were, you know, helping figure stuff out. And now, of course, you know, with a whole new chapter, we put the tent and we put the sprung building up, and we put the tent inside the sprung building. Then we put the truss inside the tent. So everything in terms of location was all based on where that truss, the original truss, would go. Because that has to go into its mounted footings. So that was kind of the square one when we put up the sprung structure, which has quite a bit, we've got quite a bit to do to improve it, but it worked quite well last year, and we have no more tent raisings, at least for the foreseeable future.
Yeah, you can, that new skin allows you to leave the tent up, correct?
Yep.
And then the other thing, if you could maybe talk a little bit about the fact that it just gets tougher and tougher to get a true canvas tent. Am I correct in that?
Yeah, there. Everything's gone to vinyl. You know, it's just the economics of it. You know, but the circus size tents that we got, not the last tent, but the tent before, they were actually already pulling the equipment out, and they definitely had to put all the equipment back into the factory in order to build the last tent that we had. But the other thing that was happening is the people that were sewing the tent retired before the last tent that we got. So they had to pull people out of retirement. And then the other thing is buying the canvas. And you can't just go and buy a small lot like what you would need for a tent. You got to buy, you know, each of these rolls is literally like a kilometer long, you know, when you're buying massive fabric like that. And then, of course, it has to have all these specs, and it has to be treated for fire. And just there are just so many things that were working against us. And the last tent that we made, as I said, they had to pull everybody out of retirement for two of them. And the last one had to have a supervisor at every location while they were working on it. So the price skyrocketed from $48,000 to $85,000, I think, something like that. So it was just, things were just, you know, I mean, if you're willing to spend a couple hundred thousand, maybe you could have got one made, but the quality was going down just because people didn't, it's a dying art. People didn't know how to do it, and just so difficult in getting the fabric, and, you know, bygone days.
I think the thing that I've always tried to convey to folks is, and thankfully with your current arrangement, you've been able to preserve that, is that both as a performer and an audience member, and I've been both many times, the feel of the room when it's wrapped in canvas, quite literally, is unlike any other venue.
You know, I had people that came up at night, and they're not looking up because you got that little rim of lights. I had people come up that really didn't even know that there was a sprung building. They thought something was different, but they're just, you know, some people just are not very aware of their circumstances, you know.
Mm-hmm.
But certainly, even if you know it's there, and I used to tell people, hey, like using the Tommy Nelson sign that he has there at the Broke Down, where he says, the blue building goes away at night. So the sprung building goes away at night. You can't see it, you know.
Yeah.
So, and I don't think it's necessarily ugly. I think it's pretty incredible technology. You know, it's the only stress membrane building like that that you could put on an uneven surface. So that sprung building is the bottom semicircle is level. Then we have 110 feet of 6-degree rake. And then the upper semicircle is level too. And that was necessary just for the engineering for the thing to stay together. So, and that's about the extreme of any that they've ever put up like that. So, you know, we were kind of pushing the limits on a whole bunch of stuff. We always have, you know. And of course, at Big Top, there was no book telling us how to do any of this, you know, from day one, which has always been rather exciting, very organic.
The good news is that place has always had appeal from day one, long before I ever darkened a tent flap. It's had a certain feel. That feel has been preserved, even with all the adjustments and changes you've had to make. And good news is that based on our conversation just now, we know that when the time comes that we can open those flaps again, it's standing and ready to receive the audience.
It's pretty special what we have up there, and the tent is just fitting for it.
Well, that was fun, having Phil take us behind the scenes, behind the canvas, as it were. Tonight's BCO flashback is melancholy, but it also speaks to the spirit of this place. In July of 2016, a benefit concert was held to help longtime BCO string wizard T. Bruce Bowers deal with some medical bills he and his family had to navigate. And the benefit gave a glimpse not only of the joy and power of music, but of the caring soul of the Big Top Chautauqua staff, the audience, and the band members who shared the stage and loved sharing the stage with Bruce. Bruce is gone from this world now, but the music from that evening, and even Bruce up there playing, lives on.
She said, "I've got to go, but my friend can't stick around. Everybody has said, take a load off, man. Take a load off, man. Take a load off, man. Everybody, hey, you put the load around." Just old Luke waiting on.
T. Bruce Bowers with the BCO. In keeping with that memory, here is a song performed by today's BCO, a song written by Ed Willett in, I was going to say in memory, but really just a song written of and for Bruce.
We're going to play you a tune that I wrote called That Heavenly Session. And I wrote this tune for Bruce Bowers while he was still alive. It came about... I was thinking about him a lot because he had just decided not to do any more chemotherapy. So I started this tune on a Sunday morning, and after just a day full of driving around, I just stopped in on him. And as luck would have it, he was awake and he was, had a lot of energy, and we had an excellent, excellent time. And he was talking about what he called his transition, and he was explaining what he believed was going to happen, and it was just a inspirational time. He was just radiant, and it was an amazing experience. So I went home that night and I finished the song, and I put in some of what he had told me about what he thought he was going to how it was going to go down, and so we want to play this for you. This is called That Heavenly Session.
BCO getting heavenly for one of their own. You know, once upon a time, there was a little operation called the Nelson Ferris Concert Company. And they came up here and put on a show called Souvenir Views. It was in celebration of Washburn, Wisconsin's centennial. And it was really the first time that the Shawamigan Bay had been witness to the talents of Warren Nelson and Betty Ferris. And it also began an ongoing collaboration with area performing artists. And many of those artists went on to become the cast and crew of the Lake Superior Big Top Chautauqua. The finale of that show was a Warren Nelson song called Little Town on the Big Lake. And here's today's BCO to perform that song for you now.
From Pollock Hill to Slab Town, by the old mill sites on the bay. From the famous hamburgers at Patsy's to coffee at the Time Out Cafe. From Benderville up Protestant Hill to the old flowing well in the park. This is my home. This is my town, I know my way around. Leave my bones here when my eyes go down.
From Barksdale to Egg Beach to Houghton, where Houghton Falls falls in the spring. From the old stage door
last and all the time.
now from a little town on a big lake, we head out to the farm and close our virtual New First Night with a selection from another Nelson Ferris production called 30th Star. Here's the BCO performing New Barn Floor.
The harvest I best remember was the year of our new barn. Our place was last to be threshed, and it seemed the whole county came to dance the harvest home. The same men, women, and children who'd come to our place in June to help put up the new barn. Trading labor we called changing works. Barn raising was something to see. When I thought everyone was exhausted asleep that night, I snuck barefoot out into the new barn. I could smell the fresh oak sawdust and the green sniff of new-mown hay, and the moon was so bright it was loud in the stillness. I walked quiet into the barn, and there, at the far end, was my mother and father, holding each other. I see that scene forever. Now, our place was the dance barn because my folks loved to dance. And at the harvest dances, oh, my mama could step. And my dad would say to all the neighbors as they come to the barn, "Now I want to see you all work those dance boots." Here comes David, Hamlin's uncle. He was the fiddler.
Steam.
Gone
the cradle and flail.
Got the power pushed by steam.
Come another new day on the old farm with a tractor and gasoline.
The tractor and gasoline.
Gents, shed your tools.
Ladies, lay down the yarn. Come Saturday night and Sunday best.
There's a fiddler in the barn. Yes, there's a
fiddler in the barn. Now we'll dance the harvest, dance the harvest, dance the harvest home. Fresh the wheat, jar the garden, pick and store the corn. Call all the neighbors over who came the spring before. To raise the barley, all the rafters lift and hinge the door. Now let's dance the harvest home.
Well, folks, that's our Tiny Tent Show for tonight. Now more than ever, we thank you for your time and attention. Hope you're taking care of each other out there, taking care of your neighbors. We especially want to thank our sponsors for tonight's show, Jim and Joy Perry, Brownstone Pharmacy, Star North up there in Cornucopia, Jim and Joanne Collins, Ashland Daily Press, Big Top Friends, the Bujolds, the Manleys, the Sandstroms, and the Roths, Myra Ainert, and Movement Matters. And now the time has come, not to bid you adieu or to say goodbye, but rather to do as we say around here. Well, I suppose, forward.